to the heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Just women and men, the position in us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walk through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down, and we stand up. Shots, we on the ground, the camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop, and we ran up.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure. Oh, glory,
glory, glory.
Oh,
glory, glory.
Now the war is not over, victory isn't won, but we'll fight on to the finish, and then when it's all done, we'll cry glory, oh glory, oh
glory,
we'll cry glory, oh glory, oh.
Selma is now for every man, woman, and child. Even Jesus got his crown in front of a crowd. They march with the torch, we gon' run with it now. Never look back, we done gone hundreds of miles. From dark roads, heroes, to become a hero. Facing the League of Justice, his power was the people. Enemy is lethal, a king became regal. Saw the face of Jim Crow under a bald ego. The biggest weapon, it's to stay peaceful. We sing, our music is the cuts that we bleed through. Somewhere in the dream we had an epiphany. Now we right the wrongs in history. No one can win a war individually. It takes the wisdom of the elders and young people's energy. Welcome to the story we call victory. The coming of the Lord, my eyes have seen the glory.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome, welcome, welcome once again to the 2020 International Association of Black Actuaries annual meeting plus, as we're calling it. Of course, we're not in our normal format. We were able to see all of your amazing faces, but we are excited to be able to deliver this type of content in this deliberate way. Over the next course of the next couple of days. So for starters, everyone, I'm Chris Cooper. I have the awesome pleasure and privilege of being your virtual host for this amazing experience. And I want to welcome each and every one of you guys today to this session, one that we've been definitely looking forward to as we explore racism, specifically in the actuarial profession. So I want to first begin with, once again, I'm Chris Cooper, originally from Philadelphia, where we actually would have been. but I am a number one best-selling author, coach, trainer, speaker, peak performance, business, all that kind of great stuff. But what I'm really committed to is ensuring that individuals are able to, as I would say, execute their passion and ultimately live the life that they've been designed and created to ultimately live. And I'll just say this, that over the past couple of months, given the civil unrest, given all the things that have happened, I've had the awesome pleasure and privilege of facilitating and engaging and participating in discussions quite just like the one that we're having today about racism. Now, as I said, over the last couple of months, I've been on lots of different platforms, all that kind of great stuff. But as I always do my research and I always do different types of things, and being almost 10 years strong with this incredible organization, I thought that I really wanted to ultimately set the stage for where we are. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to first begin with kind of an overview of the history, not only of racism, but of racism specifically in the insurance industry. And then we're going to get into a live interactive discussion with many of the leaders in the International Association of Black Actuaries. And you're going to have your opportunity to actually ask questions and have a wonderful, wonderful discussion. So let's go ahead and get started. I'm going to bring the presentation up. All right, I believe that I am audible. I just want to make sure that we have no technical difficulties. So everybody gives me a thumbs up or something to let me know that we are good to go. All right, I see hands raised. Excellent. All right, so let's jump into this. So as I was saying, we find ourselves at a very interesting, I guess, crossroads of sorts in history. And I'm reminded, as I said, as everything has been unfolding over the last couple of months, as we can see, everyday people to celebrities, to corporations, to a lot of individuals are speaking out. But I want to set the context for you, if I may, as to why these things are happening and why now and why we are where we are today. And I think it goes back to this. I had an awesome experience looking, you know, researching, looking at different types of things. And there's an actual YouTube channel of a former athlete who actually used to be a former Philadelphia Eagles. I'm a big Eagles fan. And his name is Emmanuel Acho. And he has this YouTube channel where he talks about uncomfortable conversations with a black man. And I believe that many of you guys, I know that we have lots of black actuaries on here. I know we have lots of what we consider to be allies that are non-black, but are definitely down for the cause and want to understand what they can do. And he created this channel specifically for that. And I want to basically set the stage and make you understand exactly how we got to the point that we are today. And in that, he actually talks about an example of people were asking him, well, oh my gosh, Emmanuel, why are people rioting? And why are people so upset? And why are people so mad right now? And he went back to a quote from the late great Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And he said that rioting is the language of the unheard or the oppressed. And see, as we look over history, you know, back in, you know, the 1960s, you know, peaceful protests and all that kind of stuff. And we were saying we're oppressed and individuals, it fell on deaf ears. We made some progress, but it began to fall on deaf ears. And then even fast forward to 2016, Colin Kaepernick, you know, he stood up. Actually, he knelt, right, for understanding, bringing attention to the atrocities that were happening against black and brown individuals all across the world, specifically in this country. And guess what? He was silenced, and they made it an example of him defying the American flag, which was not the conversation. So here we are again, and we had, as you can see, through all of the things here, from President Barack Obama to Selena Gomez to Gigi Haddad to Michelle Obama and everybody else, that when everything happened, came to almost like a head with this example, a collision of sorts, as I would call it, when George Floyd was literally murdered in front of each and every one of us to see live on camera from multiple areas. And I think at that point, even the people that wanted to deny that this was not real, and it was not happening, had to say, yes, it's an issue. And Emmanuel on his YouTube, he talks a little bit about the fact of an example. And he says, think about that you're biking, right? And he said he was biking one day along, I think, Lake Austin or something like that. And he was riding his bike and he was about 15 meters away from a young white Caucasian young lady who was on her bike and she was riding. And he was riding on his bike and he was 15 meters away. And he says, on your left. And she keeps, you know, and so he keeps riding and she keeps riding. Then he's like, oh my gosh, I'm 10 meters away. And he says it again, on your left. And she continues to keep on going. And then he's 5 meters away and he understands that if she doesn't move, there's going to be a collision. And he gets 5 meters up, he says, on your left. And she can't hear him because she has her earbuds in. And eventually they literally crash and they clash. And because they've crashed and they collided at that particular point, that is where we found ourselves when we all saw that horrific video of George Floyd being murdered, literally in front of all of our eyes to see. So guys, we're at a point right now where the collision is here and there has to be a better way and there has to be some decisions that are strategically created, designed, and implemented to get us forward. So when I tell you that story, because that's why everyday people are speaking out. That's why celebrities are speaking out. That's why, you know, we are over 600 strong right now, waiting to have the conversation, as I would say, an uncomfortable conversation, not only with a Black man, but with Black actuaries all across the world. So let's continue. So what is this all about? Once again, while the recent murders of Black people have drawn unprecedented worldwide attention, they are only the most recent events in a long stream of lives lost too soon. And as you can see, we can go on literally for hours, the amount of names that have been taken by law enforcement and other means that are definitely, as we would say, are gone definitely too soon. And check this out. Basically, what's happening is while policing policies, including brutality, has been a focus of recent events, it's also highlighted that the issues go beyond just the policing. The struggles of the Black community are not new, but it is a result of systemic oppression that's had a long history. Just like that example that I gave you of on your left, we've been saying for years, we're oppressed. But for some reason, individuals have had their earbuds in and were either blind or not listening to exactly what was happening along the way. So having said that, I'm so excited that we had an amazing team behind this. And we put together what we consider to be a timeline of oppression and progress, because guess what? We're not saying that things have never been okay and, you know, and that we haven't made some strides. Yes, there has been some, but guess what? Every single progressive advance came with some more oppressive techniques and tactics that have caused us to spiral backwards, even now in 2020. So as you can see, this is the beginning of a timeline, and I'm going to highlight specific things. And then even as I highlight these specific instances and pieces of the history of oppression and progress, specifically as it relates to the insurance industry, I'm also going to highlight specific dates and examples of what things have happened specifically when it comes to insurance. So as we all know, in 1619, that was the beginning of the slave trade in America. Maryland passed the first banning interracial law in 1644. In 1704, check this out, understand this, the Slave Patrol was founded. Slave patrols are the origin of policing in the South. As we move along, through the 1700s, there was a lot of things that were ultimately happening. I'll make sure that, you know, the first anti-slavery society was founded in Pennsylvania in 1775. The importation of slaves was outlawed technically in 1808. But once again, lots of things were, yes, some things were happening to create some progress, but a lot of things were happening to draw us back to where we were previously. And as you can see in the 1840s, the number of slaves insured in the South was equivalent to the free whites that had life insurance in the North. Just think about that. But let me break it down even further. What is slave insurance? And they're like, okay, Chris, what the heck is slave insurance? Slave insurance, check this out. It says, while many are only familiar with farming, such as cotton, as an occupation for the enslaved, after importation was outlawed, many slave owners rented out slaves to skilled industries such as blacksmithing, carpentry, construction, coal mining, and steamboat operations for additional income. There were many occupational hazards that accompany these skilled jobs, and slave owners sought to insure not their people, but guess what? Their property, taking out policies on the enslaved to ensure compensation in case of peril. So what I'm saying here is understand this, that, and I love this, that this was actually said by Michael Ralph and William Rankin. It says that slave insurance was one of the earliest forms of industrial risk management, providing an important source of revenue for some of today's largest multinational corporations and companies. Slave insurance. So we're talking about that way back in 1840. So let's go along. So at that time, of course, it was a booming business. We move along, you know. Technically, in 1863 to 1865 was the freedom of the enslaved, and I'm doing that intentionally, and many of you guys know why. So from that perspective, look, in 1865, as we all know, 1 month prior to his assassination, President Abraham Lincoln signed a bill that established the Freedmen's Bureau, and it was supposed to be around for about a year post the war. Now, the goal of this Freedmen's Bureau was to assist the over 4 million individuals that were newly free. So over 4 million individuals. And there were a couple of things they wanted to ensure. Number one, providing food, housing, and medical aid. Number two, establishing schools. Number three, offering legal assistance. And number four, settling former slaves on land confiscated or abandoned during the war. Look, this is where we get that whole concept of 40 acres and a mule. Now, citing preferential treatment for one group versus another and a huge financial burden, President Andrew Johnson vetoed an extension not once, guys, but twice. Johnson continued to undermine the Bureau. And guess what? As we're seeing even in modern day, sometimes the Congress succumbed to the pressure, and basically the Bureau was dismantled in 1872. Now, I want to tell you, once again, we're talking about insurance, we're talking about slavery, we're talking about the impacts of oppression and the systematic way in which this was created. And we're showing you live examples. So I hope that, you know, not only all of the Black actuaries out there are taking notes, but I also hope that each and every one of you guys that are considering yourselves our allies are also taking note to understand how we got to where we are today. Also in 1865, Mississippi and South Carolina enacted the first Black codes. These included Blacks to have written evidence of employment for the coming year each January. Number two, Blacks would have to forfeit wages and risk arrest if they broke a year-long contract of work. Number three, there were only limited occupations that Black freed Blacks were able to do, and it allowed for farmers or a farmer servant via taxing others. And then number four, as you can see, basically they could buy property, but many states limited the type of property that they could ultimately purchase. These Black codes were enforced by, check this out, all white police and all white judges, many former Confederate soldiers who we already know have a internal intrinsic bias toward the individuals. And this is what we consider to be the new Jim Crow laws. Now, as things went on, you know, we can move right along to 1875 here. In 1875, Prudential, right? An insurance company, right? Prudential pioneered industrial insurance policies and made those available to Blacks. Now, in the 1980s, I do want to highlight one more thing. I know we're talking about the industry. In Blacks-owned mutual aid societies were founded in 1810 as well, leading to the establishment of the first Black insurance company, Southern Aid Life Insurance Company in Richmond, Virginia. And in 1893, the largest Black insurance company, which is North Carolina Mutual Life Insurance Company in Durham, North Carolina in 1896. So once again, as these insurance policies were being created and as Blacks were beginning to get involved in this I guess this financial increase, you know, and being able to have property and insurance and that kind of stuff. I want to show you that there was some progress, but once again, every time there was progress, it was met with opposition. So, as you can see here in March 1881, Prudential announced the policies held by blacks would be worth one third less than the same policies held by whites. Once again, here we go. One third less than the same policies held by whites. This action was defended years later after anti-discriminatory insurance laws were passed by statistically proving higher mortality rates for black people. So because black people die more often, therefore what we're going to do is we're going to make sure that those policies are worth one third less than how we would normally insure a white individual. So across the industry, companies blocked and disincentivized agents from soliciting black customers, including not paying commission checks for policies sold to blacks. And we all know in the insurance industry that commission's a good part, right? That's part of what the kickback that individuals insurance agents get when they sell an actual policy. So the fact that you sell a policy to a black person and it's basically null and void and you don't even get paid for it. And I love this. This actually comes from a political scientist, not an actuary. His name is Brian Glenn in 2003. And he says, the myth of the actuary is the idea that there is a reality in the world that can be captured by rational choice models and statistical analysis, and that insurance companies do this ethically, objectively, and correctly. And I think we all know the answer to that. It was done none of those ways. So in the 1880s, like I said, that was actually the formalization of the police. That was a formal race-based insurance pricing. Mississippi passes the first poll tax. The Actuarial Society of America was formed in right around that time. 1889 and the 90s. Lots of things happening. Hoffman, the race traits and tendencies of the American Negro, Louisiana limits voting for blacks via the grandfather clause, and the black national anthem, was actually created right around 1900. And also, check this out. This is when black wealth was booming, because once again, individuals were not allowed to be, there was no integration. We were not included with everyone else. So therefore we had to create ourselves, kind of what they would say, for us, by us. And in that season, black wealth was absolutely booming. And guess what happens? Once again, every time we reach a point, we get knocked back. So the race massacres of 1900s to the 1920s, with growing economic wealth in black communities came racial terror for whites. Did you get that word? Notice the words, terror for whites. Racial massacres occurred in over 26 cities, killing thousands, destroying thousands of homes and businesses, and leaving tens of thousands of individuals homeless. Of course, we all know about the Tulsa massacre and things like that. Newspapers removed, check this out. There is no justice served for those killed and no repayment of economic value lost. Wondering why you didn't learn this in school? Guess why? Because guess what? Newspapers removed articles from their archives, and police and state militia archives went missing as part of a news blackout. According to the State Department of Education, US history classes have had to teach about this since 2004. Now, like I said, I'm going into detail because I wanted to set the stage. But in 1930s, the federal mandated exclusion, the FHA, Federal Housing Administration, started in 1934, explicitly and purposefully excluding blacks by, number one, refusing to insure mortgages for blacks. Number two, subsidizing mass production builders with a requirement to not sell to blacks. Number three, FHA required that deeds were restrictive covenants where they could not be resold to blacks. These policies were explicit, written in underwriting manuals, and existed for 30 plus years. The Supreme Court upheld this practice until 1948. And to put everything into perspective, 85% of New York subdivisions had restrictive covenants. Come on now. So let's move along. There's a lot of things that happened. Of course, in the 1960s, as you can see, large insurance companies retire race-based mortality tables, and tables existed for small companies in the 1980s. Of course, in 1964, the Civil Rights Act was passed. And once again, race massacres erupt, as you can see here. And as we move along into present day, to 2000s, major newspapers apologize for historical reporting. They say, we propagated a worldview rooted in racism and the sickening myth of racial superiority. in 2015 and 2018, public criticism of zip code-based insurance pricing began to kind of buzz a little bit. And then HR 1756 was introduced, preventing credit score discrimination in auto insurance just last year in 2019. So having said that, there were some specific insurance-related events, and I just want to highlight these really quickly. In 1840, slave industry, as I said, was booming. The number of insured slaves in the South rivals the number of free whites in the North, top modern-day multinational companies. In 1881, once again, as we said, Prudential is the first company to introduce formal race-based pricing. Major companies follow suit. The Northern state legislators ban racial discrimination, and insurance companies pull out of those actual markets. In 1893, Southern Eight Life Insurance Company founded in Richmond, Virginia, and was the first Black insurance company. As I said, it evolved out of the Black Mutual Aid Societies, which went back to 1810, as I said. In 1896, Hoffman publishes Race Traits and Tendencies of the American Negro, scientifically justified racial segmentation. W.E. Du Bois and Howard University mathematician Kelly Miller contested these conclusions of this quote-unquote statistical study. In 1896, North Carolina Mutual Insurance Company, founded in Durham, North Carolina, became the largest Black-owned insurance company. 1930s, once again, explicit federal segregation via the Public Works Administration and the FHA, impacting where people can live, of course, which goes to zip codes, and we all know what that means when it comes to insurance policies. In 1932, the first Black actuary, non-exam, Asa T. Spalding, via a master's degree from the University of Michigan, Poplar University, responsible for five of the first 11 Black actuaries. In 1944, the GI Bill passes that limits access to over $33 billion in mortgages given out to Black veterans. In New York or New Jersey, less than 100 of 67,000 mortgages insured under GI Bill went to Blacks. Of course, this highlights the disparity in Black home ownership. In 1945, Robert G. Randall starts sitting for actuarial exams while pursuing a master's at Columbia University, and he's believed to be the first time any Black person sat for an exam. In 1952, Robert J. Randall earns his FSA and becomes the first Black fully credentialed actuary. In the 1960s and 1980s, scientific racism disavowed. Life insurance companies retire race-based mortality tables for new sales. Lawsuits settled in the early 2000s address premium and benefit corrections for Blacks. In 2015, the Consumer Federation of America publishes a study. Drivers in predominantly Black communities pay more for mandatory auto insurance. 20 to 194% higher than our counterparts. The American Property Casualty Insurance Association counters and reaffirms that pricing is based on cost and credit is not discriminatory. In 2017, ProPublica, an article examined racial discrimination in auto insurance, found minority-dominant zip codes were overcharged. In 2018, the Consumer Federation of America writes to the NAIC to urge them to tackle racial discrimination caused by zip code-based pricing. And in 2019, the HR, once again, 1756, introduced Preventing Credit Score Discrimination in Auto Insurance, sponsored by Congresswoman Rashida Tlaib. And in 2020, check this out. In 2020, there are approximately 1% of credential actuaries in the world are Black, and that's via the SOA and the CAS. The NAIC announced social codes as well, and that's kind of setting the landscape for where we are in 2020. Now, words to ponder on the path to how do we ultimately move forward. These are all things that individuals have said. But I think one of the biggest ones that just jumped out at me was none other than by Angela Davis. And I'm saying this, directly. This is on behalf of Chris Cooper, not on behalf of the International Association of Black Actuaries or anybody else that's going to be on this platform. But I'm speaking to every single ally that we have out there. I want you to understand, in a racist society, It is not enough not to be racist. We must be anti-racist. So having said that, we are about to commence the panel. I hope that you enjoyed our trip down, I guess, memory lane of sorts. But I want you to understand this, that history is always meant to be remembered, but check this out, not always meant to be celebrated. So it's very important that you understand that as we move forward. So having said that, I am so excited to introduce individuals on this esteemed panel. We put together, I think, one of the best panels possible on this. Let me tell you this, before we begin, before I even introduce these individuals, once again, disclaimer, their opinions are their own and have no respect to their respective organizations, their respective companies, or anybody else they are affiliated. They are just individuals that are going to speak clearly and openly about their own personal experiences when it comes to racism specifically in this industry. So to all the employers and everybody out there, this is not to be held against them. Once again, disclaimer, you heard it and it's on video, that these are their own opinions and do not reflect those of their respective organizations. So we're going to begin today. We have Ms. Kuda Shibanda, FCAS. She's a director of data science at the Hartford Board of Directors and CAS. She also served on the board of directors for the Casualty Actuary Society. Kuda lives in Brooklyn, New York, and was born and raised in Zimbabwe. Our second panelist, as you can see, Stafford Thompson Jr., FSA, a senior vice president of life product management, Lincoln Financial Group, and a founding member of, check it out, a founding member of this great society, the International Association of Black Actuaries. In his role, Stafford drives expansion, diversification, and enhancement of Lincoln's industry-leading portfolio of individual life insurance and executive benefit products. Stafford is a founding member, once again, as we said, and also past president and the unofficial historian of the International Association of Black Actuaries, and we're so happy to have him on board. The next panelist is none other than Mr. Anthony Weatherspoon, ASA, and manager at PwC, the Healthcare Actuarial Services. He serves as an actuary with years of experience in the payer, provider, and employer space. Anthony has served for many years on the International Association of Black Actuaries Annual Planning Committee and is currently serving as a friend of the board for the IABA. Next, Madam President, as I refer to her, Tanisha Magruder, FSA, actuary for Blue Cross Blue Shield of Atlanta, I mean Alabama, excuse me, I'm thinking of Atlanta because I'm in Atlanta, and president of the International Association of Black Actuaries. She has served this organization well for so many years, serving as an Atlanta affiliate leader, student liaison, scholarship chair, and as a volunteer, of course, for the annual planning committee. And we're so excited to have her leadership. Moving right along, you're going to hear from Tamantha Kyle, Senior Manager of Marketing Strategy and Analytics and Operations. She actually has a ton of experience also from her college years, moving from volunteer to the New York, New Jersey affiliate to lead our boot camp facilitator. She started her career with actuarial development programs at New York Life and Transamerica and received her ASA in 2015. Her passion for providing the financial resilience of everyday Americans drove her into tech as innovations in technology enable carriers to price on behavior versus circumstances. The next one is Nana Coleman. He is and Des Moines-based actuary and has worked for the Principal Financial Group since graduating from Drake University in 2013. Nana also helps run the IABA Actuarial Bootcamp. And we're going to round it out with Jeff Johnson, FSA, founding member as well with Stafford of the International Association of Black Actuaries, board of directors for the Actuarial Foundation, vice chair of the American Council for Life Insurers, Actuarial Committee, and G is currently an officer at John Hancock Life Insurance Company. Jeff currently sits on the board of the Actuarial Foundation and is vice chair of the American Council for Life Insurers Actuarial Committee. All right. So having said that, guys, we are so excited to have this esteemed panel. Now, listen up. I actually have some prepared questions that I'm going to be asking and addressing each of these individuals. They will give their responses. So I hope that you guys are taking notes. At the appropriate time, get your questions ready. We will have a live Q&A session following their original questions, and you're going to be able to participate in that manner. And then after that question and answer period, Madam President and myself will come and we'll close this out. But I am so excited about this discussion, and I can't wait to see how all of this ultimately unfolds. So let's first begin, once again, as I said, with Kuda. And Kuda's question. All right, are you there, Kuda? Can you see me?
I am. I can see you. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. And thank you so much for joining us. We're so excited to have you.
Thank you.
So, Kuda, I have a very specific question for you. And Kuda, I love her. She's an overachiever. So she has a graphical representation of how she's going to actually answer this question, which I think is extraordinary. So Kuda, sometimes when we talk to recruiters or actuarial employers, we hear them use the phrase, we only recruit from quote unquote good schools. How would you respond to that statement? And what are the implications of such language?
Yeah, Chris, so it's actually really interesting because the feeder school phenomenon, as I call it, is very much embedded in the hiring process. And it's not even just in the actuarial field where that happens. If you click the first one, I've included the schools that are typically known in the banking and the tech industries, right? So it's pretty much accepted at this point that if you want to go into investment banking, you should go to Wharton or Columbia. If you want to go into tech, you should go to Stanford or the University of Washington. Right, these are things that we sort of accept as facts, right? Mm-hmm. And recently, the actuarial field has started in on this trend as well. So on the next click, what you'll find are the schools that are very highly represented in, and this is CAS membership because I'm a CAS member, so I don't have the numbers for the SOA, but I'm pretty sure they're very similar. Is these are the schools that are very highly represented in our membership in the CAS, right? So Waterloo, Laval, Illinois, and Wisconsin. Now, the issue with this is there's an embedded assumption that's underlying that. We've kind of begun to accept that if you are a top candidate, you go to a top school. That's sort of how we think of that equation. And the problem is basically the last 20 minutes that you've just taken us through, right? There is this disconnect between what actually is a top candidate and where they go to school. So what I did is, because I love my numbers, I took a look at the relationship between family income and SAT scores. And it's crazy. It's monotonically increasing that as your family income increases, so does your SAT score. There's no dip. If you make less than $20,000, your SAT score is under 1,000. 20 to 40, it starts to increase, et cetera, and all the way up to 200,000 where it's above 1,100. So what this is telling me, right, is just because somebody didn't go to a top school, quote unquote, doesn't mean they're not a top candidate, because there are a whole lot of other socioeconomic variables that come into the equation. And as actuaries, I think we should be uniquely positioned to sort of understand skew and bias, right? Bias in the statistical term, not just in the sort of racial term. And so it's important for us to sort of identify it, isolate it, and then potentially remove it in what we're doing. And then if you just click one more, something that I found kind of interesting is we tend to follow on this top school feeder phenomenon idea, but when you look at banking and tech, about 5 and 6% of their employees are Black. And as you mentioned earlier, only 1% of our membership is Black. So we're following along this trend of, I wanna get top candidates. And in the process, we're actually handicapping ourselves even more than banking and tech, which are already not known to not sort of be good industries. So on the next slide then, and this is really the one that hit me home when I was taking a look at these numbers. So on the left-hand side, I have the top schools that are represented in CAS membership. And then on the right-hand side, I have the top schools for IABA scholarship recipients. So these are sort of the cream of the crop in IABA. And two things jump out at me, right? The first is the schools on the left generally don't look like the schools on the right. In fact, there are only two schools that are overlapping the two, right? The University of Wisconsin and Ohio State. The rest of our membership is sort of on the CAS side, is represented in these schools where not a lot of Black candidates are. And so what recruiters are doing by going to these so-called top schools is they're essentially biasing against Black candidates in particular, because Black candidates don't go to those schools. And there are reasons for that that have to do with sort of the disparity in awareness about the profession, which I'll talk a little bit later about. But if you remember one thing from what I'm going to show you, just remember that if you want Black candidates, you're going to have to go find those Black candidates. They're not going to fall into your lap by you continuing to sort of recruit from the same schools and just throwing your hands up and saying, well, I can't find any Black candidates at the schools I recruit to. In sort of in on the silver lining of what's been happening with COVID, right? Recruiting in a virtual format has become more acceptable. And so you can go after these schools, right? So there's a list of schools where IABA scholarship recipients came from. Go after them. They're candidates who are existing in particular in unique schools that we typically don't associate as actuarial schools. And then the last thing I'm gonna say, if you go to the next slide, is sort of just question your assumptions, right? In your sourcing and recruiting. The first thing I would ask you is, are you trying to hire because of achievement or because of acumen, right? So in the actuarial profession, people have been hiring a lot by the number of exams that you have in the school that you go to. But really, because of the 20 minutes that you just took us through, right, we are again biasing against a particular sample. And in order for us to take away that sample, we need to start thinking about whether we want students who have acumen, which I contend is more important than achievement, which is what they've done. And then the second thing is you need to be aware of that awareness gap that I talked about earlier. So IABA, together with the CAS and SOA, funded some research that showed that Black and Hispanic students tend to find out about the profession later than their white counterparts. So you need to be careful about how much you care about exams for things like entry-level positions, because Black candidates don't have exams because we don't typically find out about it until much later than our white counterparts. So just keep that in mind. And then finally, the thing about concentration risk, right? We all know about this. If you keep hiring from the same schools, you get into groupthink, you get the same kind of candidates, and you don't get the importance of different viewpoints. So that's pretty much my spiel. I would say, you know, if nothing else, remember this, that achievement is not acumen and you need to be careful about bias. So.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Kuda. I think that insight was incredible. And, you know, I really believe that at the end of the day, no, you know, they always say facts tell, but stories sell. And I think that by looking at these facts, we can, you know, unequivocally understand exactly why we are where we are. But also, I think what you just did is just give us kind of an insight as to what we could potentially do moving forward, you know, to be solution-based. So thank you so much, Kuda, for that. And Kuda's going to be back, guys, so don't worry. All right, our next individual, our next question, like I said, I've led up to him. He is absolutely phenomenal. He is one of our founding members, once again, of this incredible organization, none other than Stafford Thompson Jr. Stafford, are you there, sir?
I am.
Excellent. Well, it's good to see you. All right. So my question for you, sir, is do you see bias in how employers recruit and hire diverse talent?
Yeah, thanks, Chris, for the story. I appreciate it. And thank you, Kuda, because your presentation leads directly into some thoughts I'd like to share. And if I could leave one thing with you, I'd leave you with this. We don't fit the description. Typically, when you hear that phrase, you typically hear it when someone is being stopped by the police, and the reason given is that you fit the description. And so I have to proclaim, we don't fit the description. But that's not just out there. It is also in here, in corporate America. We don't fit the job description. When you're looking for three exams, are you really looking for three exams, or are you looking for someone that's going to become an FSA? Doug French once said he was in the business of hiring fellows, people that were going to become fellows. And certainly three exams can be an indication of that, but it's not the only indication. And so is there a one exam student? Is there a zero exam student that we can identify that will become an FSA? But we get so focused on our job descriptions that we don't even view that talent. And I wanted to share with you a personal example. And it's interesting that my recruiter is actually in the audience listening to this panel. When I became an FSA, I applied for a position and it had a reasonable job description. It was a life insurance, reinsurance pricing position. They wanted 5 years life insurance experience. That's pretty reasonable. They wanted 5 years pricing experience. That's pretty reasonable. And reinsurance experience preferred. But there was an issue. I was in an actuarial executive development program, a rotational program in a multi-line insurance company. I had done life insurance for 2 years, but that was my first rotation, and 7.5 years since I had done life insurance. So that whole 5 years life insurance experience, X, I don't fit the description. I had done healthcare pricing and retirement pricing, but only for 2 years each. So only had 4 years pricing experience and no life insurance pricing experience. X, I don't fit the description. And so as you can imagine, the HR person, and the hiring manager declined to interview me, saying he didn't fit the description. And fortunately, it was in a market that wasn't highly actuarial, North Carolina, so they weren't getting a whole bunch of folks. And finally, the senior vice president looked at the resume and said, well, what about this one? And to a person, they jumped up, no, no, he doesn't fit the description. The senior vice president said, but you're looking at what he doesn't have. I'm looking at what he does. 7 positions in 9.5 years, all progressive responsibilities. I know he can learn something. He's priced healthcare, he's priced retirement. I know he can price. Let's give him a shot. And to jump to the end, in 1 year's time after having got the job, everyone who fit the description was reporting to me. And I shared that because we're so focused on our job descriptions. Do they have 25 years experience? 25 years ago, you didn't let me do the job. So I don't have 25 years experience. But is that what you're looking for? Or are you looking for somebody that can do the job? Which is not by any means to imply going for lesser quality. It's not by any means trying to imply that you ought to have a quota system to become more diverse. What it is saying is that the way we judge talent today, our intangibles, our non-negotiables, do not support hiring diverse talent. I'm encouraging you to think outside the box and find diverse talent that can do the job and focus far less on your job descriptions. Thank you, Chris.
Fantastic, Stafford. Thank you so much for your perspective and for your personal story. You reminded me of something that I read recently. And it basically said that when the rules are clear and the ground is level, we, as in Black African-American people, we excel and we dominate, just like you did in that particular instance. But when the rules are not clear and the ground is not level, not only does society suffer, our company suffer, and everybody else suffer along the way. So thank you once again for explaining the difference between the fit conversation that comes up so much. So thanks so much, Stafford. I appreciate that. All right. So let's move along to our next question. We're actually going to go to Mr. Anthony Weatherspoon, a great man of Cap Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated. I'm about to throw that in there because he's awesome. And Tony, my question, Anthony, my question for you is, what are some key considerations for companies wishing to achieve more inclusive employment practices and greater diversity in hiring and talent development?
All right, thanks, Chris. Thanks for the introduction and thanks for the opportunity to actually be on this panel and speak about this today. First off, I'd like to say the comments from CUDA and Stafford were excellent. I think they were totally on point. I'd just like to add a little bit of additional context to the conversation around diversity and inclusion. Currently, and like over the past few years in particular circles, there's been a lot of discussion amongst employers about this concept of multi-generational workforces and also workforces of the future. Now, HR departments and benefit execs are considering policies and employee benefits in terms of how initiatives can be tailored to certain segments of their workforce now and in the future. And a large part of the conversation has kind of centered on attracting and retaining talent. And in particular, they talk about younger populations, and that's really like Gen Z or millennials, which will be a large part of the future workforce. And surveys have shown that these younger populations, and in particular, young Black employees, seek diverse and inclusive workplaces to be part of. And they want to be their authentic self. Many are actually choosing their employers based off of this. They're generally more cognizant and conscious about social unrest and also systemic racism. And they want their company's attitude and activism to be toward those areas. So the question is, like, how do employers create the type of environment that will attract diverse and in particular Black employees and allow them to thrive? So the way I think of it is, I think that any employer that's really trying to make change needs to think of what I call a four E's framework. And you touched on one of the E's in the beginning. Actually, you went through a pretty lengthy discussion, which is good. The first E is education. The second E is examination. And the third E is enacting, followed by evaluation. Now, the first step, education. As you went through, companies can't really address and combat systemic racism without a full knowledge and expertise on the subject. Employers are going to have to learn about the history of systemic racism and exactly what it does to Black employees and its impact on the Black community in general, and also how that impact might actually permeate their organization. Second step, they need to examine themselves. They need to take a real good look in the mirror. Organizations need to honestly and openly look at their internal and their external practices and see what type of organization that they are and that they want to be. And you can really look at it from this perspective. Are you ignorant to the effects of systemic racism? Are you a racist organization? Are you non-racist, as you touched on before? Or are you anti-racist? And once the organization determines exactly what kind of organization they are, what organization they want to be, then they can move forward to enacting policies. And those policies and programs can be both internal and also external facing. They can be regarding recruiting, how they're developing their Black employees into managerial and executive leadership positions, or they could be external. And it could be reevaluating arrangements that they have with their suppliers and vendors, or recruiting firms, or even their business practices. And then finally, they need to evaluate. And evaluation is honestly a cornerstone of the actuarial profession. Once you put the programs into place and the model into place, you have to determine whether or not you're achieving the desired results. You got to be transparent about your results, and you got to be accountable to them. That means you can't be afraid to readjust and realign and reassess as necessary. Now, I think if you follow that guide, most employers will have a good success towards diversity and inclusion.
Fantastic, Tony. We appreciate you. That four E's, the education, examining, enacting, and evaluation. Thank you so much once again for sharing that and giving us your perspective. And like I said, guys, as you can see, this stuff just keeps building and building and building. So the next individual I'm going to bring up is our president of the International Association of Black Actuaries, Ms. Tanisha Magruder. Tanisha, are you there?
Here.
All right. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So my question for you is, what are some examples of unconscious bias, subconscious discrimination, and aggressions in the workplace, and how can employers overcome this? I'll say it one more time because I stuttered a little bit. What are some examples of unconscious bias, subconscious discrimination, and microaggressions in the workplace, and how can employers overcome this?
So I think that this is a important topic to bring up because I think that most people don't walk out the door thinking that they're blatantly racist and they're generally good people. So, but they don't understand how these unconscious biases and microaggressions negatively impact the hiring, retention, and promotion of Black people. So I'll just share a couple of my personal experiences just to kind of highlight what happens. And even though these are anecdotal, the statistics still reflect what I'm about to say. So one example of unconscious bias. So in a prior role, I worked for a company and I was the only female there. And I don't know anything about golf, not a thing. I think bogey is one of the words or something like that, but I don't know anything about golf. So the guys said, you know, oh, let's go have a drink to watch the Masters. So they all went to watch the Masters, which turned into, oh, you like to golf on the weekends? I like to golf on the weekends. Well, naturally, when you're golfing on the weekends, you start talking about work. So then when you get to work on Monday, you know, now you guys have already kind of discussed things, and now you have this guy working on a project that I'm not even privy to. Then he does a good job on the project, so you know he's a good worker, so now he gets the good projects, and then next thing you know, there's a disparity there. And you didn't mean to do it, it's just the type of things that happen. And this ultimately led to I just felt very isolated to the point where one time we went to a client meeting and it was like, okay, we're all gonna check our bags and then we're gonna meet up and go to a restaurant. So I'm at the airport, bags are checked, walking around, where are my coworkers, you know? And they were nowhere to be found. I go and I just see them all eating at a restaurant and I'm like, you know, no one called me, texted me, nothing. I thought we were going to decide we're going to eat. And I mean, and that's what I mean by impacting employee retention, because after that, I left that company shortly thereafter because I just felt like, what am I doing? Another example is, you know, I started a company and I was there for several months and I went to the health meeting and I saw one of my coworkers and he was a manager at this company. And he said, I didn't know I would see you here. And I'm like, why wouldn't I be here? And he said, I didn't even know you were an actuary. And you may say, well, there's not that many Black actuaries. So maybe that was an okay assumption to make, but you have to understand that one, everybody in this office was an actuary. And two, you have to understand how this could impact me in the future. For example, if this manager was looking for someone to work on a project, he would not nominate me because he doesn't even think I'm an actuary and a credentialed actuary at that. So that's a real problem. And another thing about like microaggressions. So I love Marvel movies. You know, I love talking about Marvel movies, especially when they just come out. And one day we were at work and a white female coworker said to me, the only Marvel movie I haven't seen is Black Panther because I was scared to go watch it. I heard Black people got mad when you went to go see it. And, you know, I think that sometimes other people don't realize how impactful that is, right? A white woman saying she was scared of Black people, that has led to like death in our community. So it's just, sometimes you need to be aware before you say something ignorant, because it kind of can have the potential to create a toxic work environment, right? And I say all those things, and I'm not trying to say that these people are bad people. It's just, I think it's human nature to have biases, but I'm trying to illustrate these things so that people can understand that it's not always something as blatant as George Floyd that hold people back. And as individuals, some things that you can do is, you know, check your biases. There's a lot of tests. I think Harvard has a test. You can assess where your biases lie so that you can know like how you're reacting in certain situations. Also, if you want to be an ally, a lot of times I'm the only Black person in the situation. I don't always want to be the person to say, you know, that's offensive, you know, be my ally. You know, I would rather, you know, sometimes a white person say it to a white person that, you know, that's offensive to say. And I think for companies, you can do the same thing. As Anthony put, you need to educate yourselves and assess where you are. And, you know, don't allow that type, not even disallow, but hold your employees accountable. If you see that one manager is just promoting one type of person who has that culture fit, it doesn't have to be punitive, but you can say, hey, you know, why did you promote this person over another person? You know, you can have open dialogue and try to change some of these practices. Thank you, Chris.
I love it. Thank you, Tanisha. And thank you for your transparency. And of course, as the leader of this organization, to understand that even you, quote unquote, have had these issues or these problems, I think is definitely eye-opening to a lot of the younger actuaries out there and other individuals. So thank you so much for that. I definitely appreciate it. And I'm sure that everyone else does as well. So let's move along. And actually, like a dynamic duo that I'm going to be introducing, this is actually going to be both Tamantha and Nana. But before I actually ask the question, to both of them, I want to definitely acknowledge Tamantha Kyle once again publicly. She actually did all of the legwork for the history that you just saw that I was able to deliver. So I want to say thank you, you know, publicly on this forum to say that we appreciate the hard work that you put together to take us down that path, because I think it really set the stage for this conversation. So it's good to see you, Tamantha. How are you?
Good, and thank you as well.
Excellent.
You delivered it very well. Beautiful opening remarks.
Thank you. So here we are. Many insurers believe their business practices are sound and appropriate. In what ways do systematic bias in business practices exist that aren't readily apparent? And I know you're going to take it first, and then we're going to throw it to Nana. I'm not going to make him sing today. And then I know we're going to come back to you to kind of close this out. So please go ahead.
Awesome. Thank you. And I'd really like to echo Anthony's thoughts. So just really thank you for this opportunity to share some thoughts and hopefully some great takeaways. But I really want to start my answer with a quote. So it's one of my favorite quotes. I've used it over the years. Anyone that did boot camp some years ago has seen this quote. But really, Patricia Klein Cohen, she wrote a book called A Calculating People, The Spread of Numeracy in Early America. And so the quote is, how people count and measure embodies certain assumptions about the thing they are counting. This was true in the 19th century, and it is equally true today. So now we just went through a whole timeline that outlines some explicit and systematic oppression that laid the foundation for the systemic racism that we're talking about today. It has far-reaching modern-day impacts on education, zip codes, homeownership, healthcare, and professions, to just name a few. When I think back to my own actuarial training, this wasn't part of it. And then if I think about my formal education pre-college, this also was not part of it. So I think systemic bias shows up in business practices today due to a missing historical lens, where the things that you're thinking about, the variables that you're using, how are you counting, you're thinking they're fair because you're not aware to any other perspective that they might not be. And so I went to a HBCU. I was exposed to these facts and provided with this lens. But for many people, Black, white, and really all races, this is the first time they're hearing this information or connecting this information in this way. And so I would ask this question back to the audience. Now that you know this history of explicit oppression and exclusion, you have a new lens. Does this make you question underwriting, pricing, and even product delivery approaches that use variables that could be impacted by this history? And I do want to highlight that there have been a lot of organizations that have challenged the NAIC, insurance regulators, and companies to visit this topic. Most recently, the letter from the Center for Economic Justice to the NAIC and several working groups committees that highlighted a quantifiable approach to determine if variables are a proxy for race. We need to move beyond zip code is not a biased variable in and of itself, to perhaps there are some implications when using this variable that I'm willing to explore.
Excellent. Thank you so much for that, Tamantha. So let's toss the question on the other side of the fence to Nana. Nana, are you there?
I am. Can you all hear me?
Yes, we can, and we can see all you right. As well. So once again, the same question. You know, many insurers believe that their business practices are sound and appropriate. In what ways do systemic bias in business practices exist that aren't readily apparent?
Yeah, so I think, you know, I love that question. Much of my career, I should say all my career, has been as a modeling actuary, but I've got a deep interest in product and product development and how do we reach you know, populations that maybe have been historically underserved. And I think Tamantha's done well to highlight that lack of historical context and lack of historical understanding has sometimes led to missing people and miscounting people, right? So if we look at some of those things, you know, you look at wealth and the ability of wealth to aid in financial resilience. Traditionally, there's just been historical barriers for Black folks to wealth accumulation, whether it's redlining. I know we had slides that talked about explicit federal policies that made it much more difficult for Black people to purchase homes. We look at intergenerational transfers. One thing that I found in the research for this panel that was really interesting was the direction of capital flow for Black college-educated households. A lot of times you find college-educated Black folks, I think the statistic that I saw was about 45% supporting parents after they graduate, as opposed to for whites, I think that number was about 16%. So that's about three times as much. You look at the use of retirement plans, and while Black folks may save at a similar rate to white people, the frequency or what we would call habitual withdrawals are significantly higher for Black people than white people. And so all that leads to difficulty accumulating wealth. But I think one of the things that you all talked about earlier was the fact that, insurance has actually been an important thing in the Black community. From the tradition, you know, the sort of cultural tradition around mutual aid and that leading to the Black-owned insurance companies like North Carolina Mutual, like the Atlanta Life Insurance Company. Folks that worked in insurance agents, these have been respected individuals in these communities. And so it's not as if these things were important, but difficulty accessing them has been part of the barrier. And so what I would do is, you know, I would encourage us to think about the way that we develop product. I think about product development processes, and I can only speak for what I've seen in the life insurance industry, but the conversation is often around, what's our product suite? What can we sell? What do we need to do to remain competitive in the market? The way that you think about product may look different if you started that conversation with, why do we exist? What types of problems are we trying to solve for people? And as you sort of start your conversation there, asking the questions of what types of things are we asking from policyholders in this process? How are we asking them to pay? Is the way that we're asking them to pay leaving some folks out? How do we distribute this product? You know, if we're using advisors, there's something to be said for the fact that social capital matters when it comes to things like financial advising, financial planning. If I'm a financial planner, I'm not looking to try to sell policies, or a financial advisor, I'm not looking to try to sell policies to folks that don't have assets for me to manage. One thing that I've recently been talking about is non-forfeiture. You know, you've got these sort of flexible payment plans with universal life policies, but with something as simple as a term policy, which is going to be your most accessible type of life insurance, you know, you start missing payments, your policy lapses. Can we have products that are responsive to the fact that sometimes folks may have things that happen in life that may, you know, cause them to miss payments? And how do we respond to that instead of pulling that coverage? And so those are the types of things that I would like to encourage, companies to be thinking about as they're, you know, thinking about how do we better serve more people? And so I think Tamantha's got some things that I really like about, how we think about product and how we think about process. And so I just want to kick it back to her to close this question out.
Okay, Tamantha, you're back. There you go.
Oh, yes. Thank you. I always love Nana's thoughts on this topic specifically. One of the things that we did want to highlight and mention is that the lack of company-held data around ethnicity and product purchasing makes it really hard for individual companies to test their own practices for bias. So while at one point in time our industry asked about race and used this to charge unfair prices and deny sales, today with the protections that exist, it might be time to re-ask this information so that it can be surfaced the biases that are not readily apparent. So we need action, we need more companies, regulators, and actuaries that are really willing to take a deep and honest look at this and their business practices.
Fantastic. I love the call to action, Tamantha. That's exactly, we need the actionable items, and the actuary is committed to making that happen. So thank you so much for sharing that. All right, so let's move along. Our next individual, once again, an amazing co-founder of this incredible organization, Mr. Jeff Johnson. So my question to you, sir, is how does the advent of technology like big data and AI threaten to amplify the impact of historical racism and bias in insurance rating?
Hi, Chris. Let me check. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you. Yes.
Okay, excellent. Well, thank you for the question. It's actually a question that's not only relevant but being debated at federal, state, and local levels. What I like to do is just briefly level set. So imagine all the information about you and everyone in the audience, please do the same. Your photos, your texts, your tweets, your Instagram, what you buy, your clothing, your food, your music, where you buy it from, who you buy it from, what you listen to, where you go, how long you stay, the trouble you got into, good or bad, along the way, and that this information is available for inspection and analysis. Now picture that this information is not only about you, but about everyone. Well, that's a lot of big data. In the past, trying to make sense of all this data would have been akin to trying to boil the ocean. But with the advent of artificial intelligence, the simulation of human intelligence processing by machines, if you will, typically computers, and the exceptional growth in computing power, we now are permitted to do things that in the past would have been thought of as too time-consuming or impossible. One case in point, just to do the illustration, is facial recognition software. This was launched via Amazon, actually, in 2016. I didn't pay much attention to it at the time. I had heard, though, that there were problems with people of color and this recognition software, but that didn't stop it from being sold to police agencies and governmental agencies and being rolled out into production. And not surprisingly, after it was rolled out, they discovered that there was a bias in this software that it would recognize male faces but had difficulty with black and brown and women in terms of identification. What really sort of culminated is San Francisco was the first state to ban use of this software, and in 2019 it stopped being sold. But where does it connect with where I'm going and what we really should listen to? The insurance industry wants to avoid unfair discrimination. Now, we do have differences in rates. That's called fair discrimination. But the extreme example, two individuals, one black, one white, similar risk characteristics, but the black individual is charged more solely because he's black. Now, that's extreme. That's what we want to prevent. But there's a reason to be concerned about the intersection of big data and artificial intelligence. And there's four reasons why I think this is a threat when it comes to the issues of unfair discrimination and bias and how it could be amplified. And those four reasons lie in the people, diversity, transparency, and novelty. Actuaries, we're accomplished, we're intelligent, we're creative, we're problem solvers, but we're people. So we have biases. That combined with the professional ability to interject our actuarial judgment means that our biases can not only get into the process of decision-making, but are a part of the decision-making. So we should recognize that and manage those biases and challenge those biases in the decision-making process. Lack of diversity. We already mentioned that less than 1% of actuaries in North America are black. Well, think of the facial recognition software. When I looked at the case study, it was amazing to me that the artificial intelligence was only trained on white males. It was amazing to me that their customer base wasn't significantly diverse enough, so they went to present it, that no one said, hey, this doesn't work. So the lack of diversity within the actuarial profession demands that we put more emphasis on using the resources available to us, if we have them within our organization, but also reaching out beyond our actuarial departments or even our organization to make sure we get the appropriate screening and testing about what we're doing and how we're doing it. Lack of transparency. Big data is one thing, but giving that data over and having it put into a box, if you will, that we don't understand how it works or it's complicated and it can't be really communicated because it's proprietary, that's also a problem. And where it connects is the real question comes back to something that was mentioned earlier. So in your own culture, do you have a culture where people are encouraged to speak up and say something? Or do you have a culture where people are encouraged to just go along and don't rock the boat? And this becomes very important if your customer base and your marketing isn't really designed and focused on people that are black and brown. The other and final comment I want to make at a high level is the novelty. AI and big data are the new shiny item, the new cool kids on the block. It has great potential to streamline decision-making, to reduce operating costs and generate better outcomes for customers and shareholders. And there's an arms race of sorts to get this thing figured out and bring it to market. Because of this, both industry practices and regulatory activity is evolving quickly. However, a study by Kessler and Law found that, quote, when the decision makers are fatigued or are moving fast, their decisions are more likely to be biased based on cognitive shortcuts that can introduce bias. So there's a lot to be concerned about here. What I want to do is close with these thoughts. I do believe that each of these threats can be managed, but it will require conscious awareness of biases and openness to examine diverse perspectives within and outside the actuarial universe, and an ongoing dialogue between the insurance industry and people who regulate it, as well as the customers who are going to be the targets of the products. And I don't want to forget that overall, there needs to be an openness to also change the structure around decision-making as we introduce these new techniques and ways of developing the underwriting prices and ultimately the prices that go into the marketplace. Thank you.
Fantastic, Jeff. Thank you. I'm taking notes like everybody else, but definitely I love the fact that you really humanized this problem and really brought it home and put us into a real life example of what's happening when it comes to these new shiny objects, like you said, the AI and the big data. So thank you so much for your insight. Mm-hmm. It's always well appreciated, sir. Thank you. All right. And our last question that we have prepared is going to be for CUDA. And then I already see all of your questions coming in. So guys, hang tight. We're going to get to as many as we possibly can. So CUDA, are you there once again?
I am here. Can you see
awesome.
Me?
Awesome. All right. So many employers have said that they have not, check this out, been aware of racism in the workplace. How prevalent is this, and why haven't their Black employees reported this racist behavior?
Yeah, so there's a couple of issues, right? So the first is that in America, racism is defined in the extreme. We think of racism as you're either in the KKK and you're evil and you're a racist, or you're not. And if you're a nice guy, you can't be racist. Those two things can't exist together. And so we sort of have this black and white mentality of racism. Mm-hmm. What's actually happening with racism is, and give me some rope here, I'm an actuary after all, is that racism isn't a Bernoulli distribution of one or zero, meaning it's not binary, right? You're not one end or the other. It's actually more like a gamma distribution, where you have a lot of people who are on the quote unquote low end of the extreme, right? So these are the microaggressions and the unconscious biases that Tanisha was talking about earlier, who are well-meaning people. They're not bad people, but they do persist sort of systematic behaviors in the workplace. And of course, there are a few people who are in the extreme who still want to bring back the KKK and want all of that, but there are very few of them. So what we need to do is actually focus on those sort of low severity, but very high frequency sort of infractions against racism in the workplace. So that's the first problem, is we need to stop defining racism as a black and white thing. You are either racist or you're not. There are racist behaviors and there are no racist behaviors, at least in the workplace. The second thing is there are just not enough of us, right? So Tanisha's story earlier rang true for me, and I'm sure for everybody else who has been sort of carrying the race in the workplace. I know whenever I'm the only black person in the room, which is a lot, right? I think to myself, well, I'm carrying the race. Is what they said racist? Am I crazy? Who am I supposed to tell? Who's going to believe me? And so this is what I believe. I think it is necessary for corporate America to take the template that sexual harassment training has taken and apply that to racism. So instead of just defining racism as it's either somebody called me the N-word at work and therefore they're racist or not, we should get a sort of gradation of behaviors that everybody starts being trained on this gray area. So if you think of sexual harassment training in the workplace, right? It used to be that the standard was it's either something was criminal that was done to you in order for action to be taken in the company. And now we've come to this place, especially after Me Too, where companies are starting to understand that there's gray area where they need to take action. And in particular, where sexual harassment training has really made strides in recent times is they've stopped focusing on intent and started focusing on actions. So it doesn't matter if you're a nice guy in the workplace, if you're doing something that is considered sexual harassment, that's still a problem. It's how the victim is perceiving what you're doing as opposed to what you think you're doing. So I would really encourage companies to, first of all, instead of just dismissing things and saying that's not racist because you believe you're not racist, I would challenge you to say most people, if not all, have done something that perpetuates racism in the workplace. That's uncomfortable, but it's probably true. And then the second thing is you need to have more Black people in your organization. And I recognize that takes a long time for you to have. But in the meantime, the Black people you do have in your organization, you need to take time to listen to them. Listen to their experiences, listen to their exposures. And instead of coming to the table with a, well, I don't think that's racist, come to the table with, I didn't realize that could be racist. And ask questions, because that's what's important towards you understanding the problem. So at the end of the day, everybody needs to look at themselves in the mirror and stop sort of putting the impetus on their Black workers to only come to them when somebody has done something really egregious that everybody would agree with. So
wow,
that's what I would
fantastic,
say.
Kuda. I mean, you hit the ball out the park with that one. So thank you. As you said, you know, typically, you know, you can even break it down to when individuals are abused, and sometimes they don't want to tell on the abuser. But once again, as in my example, guys, we're screaming. We are sounding the alarm. We are oppressed. Help us not be oppressed anymore. So thank you so much for everybody checking in with their own personal biases and moving toward it. So now we actually, thank you so much. Those were all the prepared questions. Now we're going to move into somewhat of a lightning round of sorts as we dive into the answers from questions from the audience. And I'm getting these questions from our production team. And ironically, Kuda, you're back. You're the actual first question. So I think that it kind of piggybacks off of what you just said. But it says, what is the best way to be anti-racist and not just non-racist in recruiting for openings at your company?
Yeah, so as it pertains to recruiting, I think the first thing you need to keep in mind is one of the first things I said in the first question, which is that you need to understand that not all top candidates go to quote unquote top schools. Right? So you need to understand that you're going to be able to get really good candidates that go to schools that you don't typically think of as being top schools, and therefore recruit at those schools and be open to going to those schools and finding those candidates. That's the first thing. The second thing I would say, it comes from my second question, which is that you need to be able to look in the mirror and address the harsh reality that the corporate atmosphere in America is such that it perpetuates microaggressions and unconscious biases that systemically disenfranchise Black people. Those are the ways to start off being anti-racist. And once you accept and acknowledge that truth, then you can move forward. Before that, I would say you can try doing a lot of things and you can talk about how much you're trying, but you're not really going to make any strides. The first stride really has to start within, and then you can go without. So.
Fantastic. I love it. So let's move along. Our next question is thrown over to, one second. Here we go. Lots of messages coming at the same time. Does Tanisha Magruder, you're next up. And the question says, does the IABA have a job board or recruiting context an employer can leverage?
Yes, we have a job board. It's open to all employers. There is a fee to join our job board. But what I would say is, most of our members respond to engagement. So if they see you at the annual meeting, if they get to interact with you, if some of our members work there, that's the better way to recruit than just posting on the job board. So I would be cognizant of that. If you're looking to be involved with our organization, don't just try to post on the job board to engage our members, because I mean, it could be in addition to doing something else, but that can't be the sole way you're recruiting, because you might not have the type of results that you would like.
Thank you. All right, our next question goes to Stafford. Stafford, are you there, sir? I'm sure you are.
Sure.
And the question says, what do you believe is the main challenge that keeps Black actuarial students from passing exams faster?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. If I give you some historical context, as Black students were going to those non-actuarial schools, but finding some support from math professors and those types of things, I think many of us that are actuaries are fully aware that the exams are just different. This is not studying for a final for a college course. This is not studying for the SAT or the ACT. This is just different. So understanding those differences is tough when you don't have the support of a Waterloo or a Wisconsin or those or Illinois State, where those programs are entrenched in how to study and pass for exams. And so you're finding that many African-American Black students, African students are learning how to study for actuarial exams on their own. And so many of us have taken it and we know what it's like when only 30% of the population is passing and you're going up against folks that are trained to pass. It becomes a process to learn and understand what it takes to get across that finish line. We do learn it. We do figure it out. We go out and we kill it. But that process can take a moment longer. In addition to what you heard from, hey, people are finding out about the profession later. So as you find out about the profession later, you start later. If you start later, you're going to have fewer exams under your belt when you meet folks. And so those are some of the contributing factors that really cause the delay, if you will, but pretty passionate about the fact that Black actuaries do get there. That's all I got.
Chris, if I may, I want to jump in on what Stafford said, because I think everything that he said is actually, you know, it's everything that I've observed in the industry, right? In my own experience, I had every advantage. I decided I wanted to be an actuary in like eighth grade. My dad happened to know some actuaries, even knew some Black actuaries by the time I was in high school. I went to Drake. I was a strong exam passer at Drake. It was really aggressive. And then I got into the field and I said, you know, is this really what I want to be doing, right? How does what I do affect my community? And for me, and this isn't an excuse, and I wouldn't do it any differently because I really value all of the experiences that I've had. But I think for me, what became more important was what is the impact I'm having on my community? What does that mean? What does that look like, right? And for me to live in a city where an insurance company is probably the biggest employer, right? The company that I work for is probably the biggest employer. I can reach the CEO with an email, whatever it is. But I also know 11th graders that can't read. I know people that, you know, they go to school 6 minutes away from the building I work in. They can see it and don't know at all what we do. Like, that was the weight that I felt like I was carrying to work every day and started to sort of shift in that direction. Not saying that was great for my career, my professional development, but I would argue that that's also a thing that many Black professionals take with them to the office every day. And I don't want us to lose sight of that as well.
Okay. Thank you, Nana. I definitely appreciate that feedback. And actually, let's toss one more back to Stafford if we can. Just a follow-up to what we just discussed. The question is, what can we do to increase the diversity of student passing exams, especially considering the wealth disparity in the United States?
Yeah, so you've heard us talk a lot about awareness. And so certainly increasing that awareness. There's been a lot of focus at the high school level in attempting to increase that awareness. You just heard Nana say he found out about it in middle school. Certainly, I do think we need to increase awareness down there. The world has changed in how students find information about jobs. And so taking advantage of those digital platforms and certainly taking advantage of the opportunities to help students prepare and understand the exams. The other piece IABA absolutely owns, and that's sharing our experiences. The other thing you need to understand is that many of these kids were straight A students all through high school, all through middle school, and they get to their first actuarial exam and they do something they've never done in life. They fail. And they don't understand that failing can be a part of this process and that you can recover from those failures and go on to be exceptional actuaries. Again, only 30% of the people were actually passing the exams. And so really, us sharing our experiences that yes, we failed too. Yes, we ripped the telephone out of the wall and threw it across the room. Oops, I was at work. Us sharing those experiences is exceptionally important to encouraging people to stick with this process once they reach that first failure that they may never have experienced heretofore.
All right, thank you so much. We're gonna toss the next question over to Jeff. And it says this: with no known yet developed good ways to evaluate and understand the potential bias in very complex black box ML models and AI big data, do you have any ways that you would tackle that directly?
Well, thank you for the question. And I clearly start by saying I don't have all the answers, but I do know, going back to the example that I started with, it is unbelievable to me that Amazon could have a facial recognition software and train it on just white males. And it even makes me think that Amazon has no black employees or no black employees in a position of influence or no customers, that the customers being the people that were buying the product that they would bump into. So I guess my first thought would be within an organization, if you can pull in people with a diverse set of perspectives to, again, help test your biases, that's one thing. The other idea, and again, this is without knowing if it's legal or not, if you've got an indication of where there's going to be an impact, what about a focus group? It doesn't have to be, hey, we're bringing you in because we're going to increase your rates. How about we're bringing you in because I don't know what? And certainly from that type of interaction, you'll get a feel for the type of individuals or groups of people that are likely to be impacted. So there's some initial thoughts, but again, it's an ongoing dialogue.
Excellent, excellent, excellent. And we know that you are a proud John Hancocker. So once again, our apologies for the slide. I want to make sure that everybody is clear where you actually are employed and where you work. So we want to make sure that we say that publicly. Once again, Jeff, thank you. Next question goes to Anthony. Anthony, is there any specific suggestions for what we might encourage hiring managers to look at instead of exams?
That's a good question. I think the hiring managers should, in particular, consider their recruiting and interview process. One thing I would suggest is that when you're looking at an interview panel, did you try to get a diverse background? I know a lot of employers are considering that right now. Mm-hmm. Whether you have to pull it from outside of a business practice or however you're going to get a diverse interviewer, you should consider that. I think also there should be types of informal leadership roles that you should consider for your black employees and also your diverse candidates. Consider putting them in positions that might push them to be more leaders, and that will progress other people from recruiting perspective.
Excellent. All right. Thank you, sir. All right. Our next question is, yes, Kuda, you want to speak a little bit to that as well?
Sure. I just wanted to chime in and say that in addition to everything Anthony said, I think recruiting should not be a very, again, black and white thing. You shouldn't say, okay, this is the GPA we're looking for, number of exams we're looking for. It has to be multiple things at once. It needs to be a combination of GPA, involvement, situational, sort of, are they seeming like they're somebody who can do the job in front of you? Mm-hmm. And then sometimes using your instincts as well. So I think it's not a clear sort of black and white, only use these metrics. You need to use a bunch of them together.
Excellent, excellent. I think that kind of goes to, we had an offline conversation. I'll put Nana on the spot. I know he jumped in, but he said there's also a difference between the cultural fit versus a cultural ad. And I think that also in hiring and looking for employees for your respective organizations, I think you should also be looking at what type of individuals are going to be a culture ad, not just a cultural fit to your organization. So thank you so much. Our next question is going to go over to Tanisha. So we got quite a few different ones. They're more specific about the work of the organization. But I want to ask you this, Tanisha, are there any efforts in IAB on IABA's part to conduct unconscious bias training that employers can implement with their staff or some form of concrete documentation we can share with our recruiters to further prove our point of recruiting at more diverse schools?
I wouldn't say that IABA is the expert for unconscious bias training. It's a little bit outside of our mission, but I would say that we would be willing to partner to make sure that our companies have the appropriate resources for the training. And we would be willing to, you know, conduct some webinars or provide some information for employers that would want to join.
Excellent. All right. And also, I know, another question that came up for you, Tanisha, was simply this. How can organizations effectively support the International Association of Black Actuaries?
There are so many ways, and I'll touch on this in the closing, mm-hmm. but in the few upcoming weeks, we will be providing some recommendations on what you can do to start the ball rolling as far as effecting change within your organizations. And we will provide information of how you can partner with us. I encourage you to visit our website. There's a membership employer prospectus, and you can see all of the programs that we offer. And you know, we're always available for any questions. Our executive director is Kate Weaver. You can always reach out to her and see in which ways you can participate. I don't want to take up too much time, so I'll just let you know where the resources are and where the resources will be.
Awesome. Thank you so much. As I said, we will do a formal closeout. And also, I know that a lot of individuals, like the question box is blowing up. I'm doing my best to get to those questions and the ones that are being filtered to me from the actual production team. However, if we do not get to your question today, please know that we will be providing more information, like Tanisha just said, through formal recommendations. And there's going to also be a follow-up webinar on this topic specifically. Look, this is the first time that we've done this. And I think this is the beginning of really creating those uncomfortable conversations that are required for ultimately moving us forward in the profession. And also, like I said, we'll send out a response document. Another question for CUDA. Do you have any suggestions as to how to ease someone into a void? Okay, so I want to make sure I read this correctly because I think it's worded a little bit funny. But do you have any suggestions as to how to ease someone into, I guess, sharing their experiences and pointing out some of those biases by trying to avoid the other party becoming defensive? So kind of the communication style in which you're bringing up an issue, you're bringing light to what's happening, and you want them to understand the violation, right? But you don't want them to become defensive in receiving that information, that feedback.
Yeah, so I'm not sure if that question is going towards the perpetuator of the racism or the victim of the racism. So
the
I'll just
perpetuator. Yeah, the I think perpetuator. It's the perpetuator. Yes.
Okay. All right. So I think, you know, it's difficult because unfortunately we're in this landscape again where you as the victim have to now be considerate of the perpetuator and understand that we're in a landscape where it's very unlikely that you can just straight up call someone a racist and that turn out well for you. Unfortunately, that's not the landscape we're in. So what I actually suggest is kind of stepping back and understanding that for a lot of people, their intentions aren't sort of malicious, right? A lot of the soft racism we were talking about, the microaggressions and the unconscious bias happens because of ignorance. And unfortunately, we're still in the place where you as the victim of that ignorance and unconscious bias have to still be a bit the bigger person. That's still unfortunately the case in today's America, right? So I would suggest having a conversation where you make it clear where and why the situation made you feel uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. And what you think the other person can do. Mm-hmm. And then also, I think it's important for you as the individual to also put it out there that it makes you uncomfortable that you even had to make the other person feel better, right? Like letting them in on your feelings is a good way of connecting with people because I think if you just straight up go and call them out on something, unless it's egregious, of course, if it's egregious, then they don't deserve any grace on that one. But if it's not, I think you have to use it as an education choice and chance, even though that's not really how it should be, but that's unfortunately how it is. So that's what I would suggest.
Gotcha. Thank you so much for that. I've been pulled into lots of different conversations with D&I professionals, and I've been doing a lot of team sessions and work to kind of facilitate these conversations. So your recommendations were definitely spot on, Kuda. You didn't need my approval though. All right, Samantha, next question is for you. Do you have some advice for young actuaries who have qualified and how they can navigate their careers in this environment where we know these biases are very prevalent? Oh, did we lose you, Samantha?
Sorry about that. I had to unmute myself in several places. Can you hear me now?
Okay.
Awesome.
The question more time, or you got it?
Oh, is the question about how young actuaries should view the industry and want to be part of the solution? Or sorry,
can you break it down
to
one more time? I know you were trying to get off mute. So here we go. So do you have advice for young actuaries who have qualified and how they can navigate their careers in this environment, understanding that these biases are prevalent?
Nice. I feel like I have to say this is something that I struggled with. And I've definitely worked at companies, I've transitioned into tech and really wanted to change some of these practices that I know are not quite fair to communities that look like me and underrepresented communities, et cetera. And I will say that you do not want to die on the sword. A lot of these practices are so embedded in the insurance industry that it takes individuals, it takes a movement, but it also takes people like mentioning it, exposing people. Like I worked at a car insurance company, and I have to say 95% of my employees had no concept that redlining existed. They didn't know what that was. They didn't know what it meant. And I live in the Bay Area, Oakland. If you read the book, The Color of Law, it's a great example about redlining, what the impact was then, but how this impact played out over generations. And so my encouragement is for people to get educated themselves and spread that education and then really like slowly push, et cetera, on, oh, well, how do we now feel about this approach? And you don't want to push too hard, because I will say some of these, I will say, will have to happen at the state regulation level rather than at individual companies. A lot of people are worried about adverse selection. Well, if I don't price on this and someone does, will they then take the best risks of this approach? And so until the industry gets together to address some of these things, I do think like it is hard for individual companies to make different changes. But as actuaries, it's nice because we can do the research, we can do the studies to push the thinking within our respective organizations and not be discouraged that it might not be well received the first time. But I do think that the discussions that we're having in this industry now, the fact that over 500 people, at one point over 600 people are on this discussion, is it's the time to get involved. It's really the time to push and the time to just be a part of that change, and slowly but surely.
Excellent. Thank you so much for that, Samantha. And thanks again, once again, for putting together the historical context for this experience. All right. So our last question of the day, like I said, don't shoot me, guys. Understand. We will definitely continue this conversation. But our last question, I'm actually going to throw over to Madam President, the President of the International Association of Black Actuaries, Ms. Tanisha. And the question says, what recommendations do you have for all actuaries to facilitate a more inclusive culture within our companies, so Black actuaries beyond just recruiting?
Well, one thing I would say is some of this isn't rocket science, right? Like some of it is just go up, talk to a person, learn and understand them. When I gave the example of my coworkers going to watch the Masters, no, I don't like golf, but I like to eat. You know what I mean? So you didn't even approach me and ask me if I would just like to go just for the drinks. You know what I mean? And I think that as an individual, like I said before, just check your biases. I mean, I took the Harvard test and I had bias against gay people. And it's not that I don't like gay people. It's that when I took the test, it's saying you... you are a straight person, so you have an affinity for straight people. That doesn't make me a bad person, but you need to understand where your biases lie and then act accordingly. And I don't think that, you know, there has to be some... Now, the changes that we need to see in the U.S. as a whole is a thing, but I think just if you are leaving this conversation, you could just check your biases and act accordingly, and that could be the first step in the right direction of creating an inclusive environment.
And I think you're 100% spot on. I think it all begins with me and myself and taking an introspective view of where I stand, you know, and acknowledging the fact. I think people don't want to acknowledge. Anybody that's ever struggled with any addiction or anything like that, the number one thing that we always share with them is that, you know, acknowledgement is the first step on a road to recovery. So acknowledging that you have these biases, acknowledging that things are not okay, acknowledging that, as I said in that analogy earlier, that the field is not, or the floor is not level, right? And the rules have not been clear. So we will take an active role in earning those things out. And we have to necessarily, if we want to be part of the solution, we have to literally actively participate and not just wait around and hope that somebody else does it for us. So thank you so much for that, guys. We've had a rocket round, a lightning round of questions, some amazing individuals. Thanks to each and every one of the individuals on the panel for your input, for your insight, for your experience. I think it just added a lot of color, and I'm using that word intentionally, to this conversation. So having said that, I'm going to turn it back over to Tanisha for some closing comments, and then I'll take us out.
Okay, so first of all, as always, I would like to thank everyone for joining. I mean, I know it's in the middle of a work day and you have a busy schedule, but you still came to support us and listen to us. And I think that that's very important. And I hope that you gained a lot of insight. And I know that we're not going to, you know, solve racism in the actual industry in, you know, 90 minutes or plus, because it's like woven into the fabric of our society. But I do think that this is a great way to start those conversations and see what you can do. As I mentioned a little while ago, we will have some recommendations that we will provide to companies as far as what can they do to get started on this road of creating a more inclusive environment as far as their hiring practices, their promotion practices, just all those things together. We will also be providing some suggestions on how the actual community can work together to recruit and retain a diverse talent. And before I end, I just want to say that it's important for us to remember that the onus isn't just on IVA. You know, our Black members didn't create this issue, so they can't be the only ones responsible for, you know, solving the issue. And everybody needs to do their part. Writing a check to IAVA is not enough. You know, we do appreciate our sponsors, but at the end of the day, our members work for your companies, right? So we can only affect a certain amount of change, right? But once they get to work, that is their environment, and that environment has to be inclusive for them as well. So just remember, you know, it's not just on IAVA, it's on all of us. It's on the employers, it's on other players in the actuarial community. I think that's an important point to make. And again, like I said, I just thank you all for joining. I know we went over time and you still hung in with us. And we'll be providing, oh, and also I think someone asked, was this being recorded? Because they wanted to share it with other people. And yes, this is being recorded. And I'll just turn it back over to you, Chris.
All right. Well, thank you so much once again for your leadership and for letting individuals know how they can continue to support the next steps, right? As you said, it's impossible for any of these conversations for us to solve the problem. But I think that once again, having these uncomfortable conversations and putting ourselves in a vulnerable state where we can ultimately learn how to heal and ultimately move forward is definitely appreciated as well as necessary. So I want to just finish out with a few things, just a few reminders from a conference perspective. Once again, we will have a career fair chat event tomorrow, Friday the 31st at 11 a.m. Featuring Travelers, Aon, MetLife, Buck, Chubb, F&G Annuities and Life, GRS, Consulting, HCSC, Protective, SCORE, and Swiss Re. At 1 p.m., we will have another type of conversation, George Floyd and beyond. What does real anti-racism look like in organizations and how to lead through change? At 3 p.m., we will have our career fair chat event as well with Prudential, EY, Willis Towers Watson, AXL, ARC, CNO Financial, Highmark Health, Siegel, State Farm, and Zurich. And at 5 p.m., we will have the live broadcast of our award celebration, which we all look forward to every single year. So as individuals around, we're still over 500 strong. We thank you once again for your time. We will get the answers to your questions. If your question was here, it is being documented. You will get the answers to these particular questions, and there will be follow-up with you in regards to that. But having said that, guys, it's been an awesome pleasure and privilege to serve each and every one of you guys today. Thank you for being open. Thanking you for pushing to be a part of the solution and not just a symptom of the problem. Having said that, guys, we will look forward to seeing you all once again tomorrow as we continue with the annual Meeting Plus. Take care and God bless. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good job, Chris.
Thank you.